I can tell you this is quite a privilege today. This is John Burris and his granddaughter, Gracie Burris, and they both come today to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm going to ask Gracie, you first. I'm going to ask, do you and have you repented of your sins?
Yes.
Would you repeat that confession of faith after me?
I believe
that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And I accept him now as my Lord and Savior. So, Gracie, upon your confession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Death, burial, resurrection. John, 67 years old. I'll be 60 this year. And this is evidence that God's calling is remarkable. That it's never too late to hear the voice of God and say, yes, Lord. So, John, do you and have you repented of your sins? Would you repeat after me the confession of faith?
I believe
that Jesus is the Christ,
the Son of the living God.
And I accept him now
as my Lord and Savior.
John, upon your confession of faith, I now baptize you. Here, cup your hands. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Resurrection. Okay. Praise God. Praise God, brother. The Bible, specifically the Old Testament, I found something to be consistently true. When the people acknowledged the fall, how far they had fallen from the will and purpose and plan of God, you know what they would do? They would call an assembly and read the Word of God out loud. In the time of Josiah the king, they found the Word, and Josiah the king read the Word out loud, and people tore their clothes when they saw how far they had fallen from the absolute truth and standard of God. When they rebuilt the Jerusalem temple after 70 years of exile, they read the Word of God out loud. Why? Why? It is a worship and acknowledgement of absolute truth and the divinity of God. So tonight at 8 o'clock, here's where I'm going. Tonight at 8 o'clock, we will honor God's Word and we will call upon Him by reading that Word. I'm going to walk up to this podium tonight at 8 o'clock and start reading Genesis 1:1. It'll take us about 76 hours to read all through, out loud, the entire Bible. We'll finish up Wednesday night around midnight. And that's where you come in. Why would you miss this blessing? I have no idea if there's any slots left open, but I'm calling the church to two things today. One is that you take an opportunity to fill one of those slots and read. The power of God's Word, that you pick one of those slots. Some of you are going to think, well, I'll end up one of those books with all those names that are that long. Just make it up. That's what I do, okay? God knows their names. And then this Wednesday, that's number one, we're going to read the Word of God aloud until we finish it. This will be our church's act of worship. It's live streamed. If you want to get on our website, any time, day or night, just click a button, you can see it, watch it, participate in it, and join in the worship. Number two, Wednesday this week at 10:30, we're going to take all the vans we have to Frankfurt, and maybe you just want to meet us down there. If you got to work, you got to work. But if you're available, I believe that Franklin Graham is anointed by God for such a time as this. He's traveling to all 50 state capitals to pray and to call the nation back to God. I want to stand next to him. Not because of him, because I believe he's a man of God appointed for such a time as this. And I want this church to be a part of that calling of God and that we're not ashamed of who we are. We're not going to back down. We're not going to shut up. We're going to proclaim the good news of Christ. So Wednesday at noon, I'd like to see this church highly assembled at the Capitol steps. Come be a part of that. Today it is my goal to break down some worldly paradigms and replace that worldly paradigm with the truth from the Word of God. Some of you may not be aware of what the word paradigm even means. It is simply this. It is a theory or a group of ideas about how something should be done. I like to describe it like this. It's a method by which you do things or think about how to do things. How something should be done. How we should think. The world has a way and God has a way. And I can tell you the reality is very seldom do they match up. The world has a way. And let's call that a paradigm. A method or a way by which you live and you think and you act. And God has a way, a paradigm, a method by which we do and think and act. The reality is those two ways very rarely match up. And I find that in Proverbs 16:25. Here's what the Word of God says. There is a path. There is a way. That's what a path is. It's a way. There is a path before each person that seems right. The path seems right. But in the end, it ends in death. It ends, that path ends in death. Let's start there. Let's start there with that scripture. Why does the path that seems right lead to death? Why would a path that seems right lead to death? Who would make a path that deceives me to walk toward death? Would God do that? No. Why does it seem right and yet it is so wrong? There is a way that seems right unto a man, but in the end it leads to death. Why does it seem right? Why does it seem right? Why doesn't it immediately look wrong? If death's in front of that path, at the end of that path, why does it look so right when you're on that path? This path deceives. Listen, church, carefully. This path deceives. In fact, this path, this way, must deceive or no one would walk on it. No one would walk on a path, a road, a way that leads to death unless you're deceived. It is the great deception. For there to be a deception, there must be a deceiver and a source of the deception. Same for truth. For there to be truth, there must be someone who proclaims truth and one who speaks truth, the origin of truth. If there is a deception, it has an origin. If there is a truth, it has an origin. Can I illustrate today that it's the same road, it just goes in two different directions. There is a way that seems right unto a man, but in the end, one leads to life and one leads to death. You see, the path doesn't deceive. The path is just a path. There is someone marking out the path. And by the way, all paths are going to end up somewhere. Every road goes somewhere. This path that seems right, listen carefully to what I'm about to say. This path that seems right unto man is too short. It's too short. That's the title today. This path that seems right is too short. It won't get you to where you want to go. And anyone who follows this path will fall short of life. And everybody wants life. But it's too short. So who would make a path to death? Well, let's ask it the other way. Who would make a path to life? Who would deceive people into trading the path of life for the path of death? Who would do that? And how would they do that? And I want to emphasize that there must be a deception or nobody would walk on that path. Not if it's leading to death. He, the deceiver, would have to do something. He would have to make it seem right to be wrong. Everybody listen. He, the deceiver, in fact, the great deception today, I announce, is the deceiver makes it seem right to be wrong. And the only way anyone would stay on the path that leads to death is it seems right to be wrong. If it didn't seem right to be wrong, you would change directions on the path. This is the great deception from the great deceiver. Can I tell you where it begins? In Genesis 3:4. Three words. Three words. Here we go. You won't die. You won't die. There is a way that seems right unto a man, but in the end it leads only to death. The way is a path. It's a road. You won't die. I don't think anyone had ever lied to Eve before that day. Stay with me. I don't think anybody had ever lied to Eve before that day. She was probably a pretty trusting person. And then someone looks at her and says three words, you won't die. The paradigm in the garden up to that point was what? The paradigm, the method of communication, the method of doing things up to this point until that three-word lie was truth. In fact, can I say this? Up until that day, everybody did it. Did what? Everybody did truth. When they spoke, it was truth. You didn't have to wonder, I wonder if he's telling the truth. The paradigm was truth. But on this day, another paradigm was introduced, another way, a new theory about how something should be done. Yes, I know. This doesn't match up with what God had said about the tree. What tree? The knowledge of good and evil. If you eat of that tree, you will surely die. You won't die. Well, somebody's not telling the truth. But no one has ever deceived Eve before. So what's she going to do? Up until this point, no one's ever lied to Eve before, and now you won't die. And you know what? I have a feeling that it was a pretty good-looking fruit on that pretty good-looking tree. And it was a pretty good sales pitch. You won't die. And guess what? Eve was not too short. I want you to visualize Eve walking up to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And there's fruit hanging on the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A literal tree with literal branches and literal fruit. And Eve is not too short. She's not too short. She was able to reach the fruit of the forbidden tree. It'd be one thing if she went up to the tree and she reached up, but she can't reach the fruit. But Eve's not too short. The fruit is within her reach, and there it is. And in her ear, she hears these words, you will not die. But she hears another set of words, you will surely die. The path of Satan, the path of the serpent, was not too short for Eve to reach the tree. I want you to visualize something, that what Satan did, the deceiver, there is a way that seems right unto a man, but in the end it leads to death. What Satan had done is he had built a path, a way, all the way up to the base of the tree. And now Eve stands at the base of the tree and she's not too short. She can reach. Eve was tall enough and the path was long enough, but that's not the real problem. That's not where I'm going. Eve was tall enough, the path was long enough. The problem of the path and the fruit, what was the problem? The path is long enough and Eve's tall enough. So what's the problem? The problem was not about today. Listen. The problem of that event that took place with a literal person in a literal tree, in a literal path, and a literal truth, and a literal lie, the problem was not about today. The problem was about tomorrow. The problem is about tomorrow. The path of today is the one that always seems right. Stay with me. The problem of today, the path of today, there is a way that seems right unto a man. In the end, it leads on to death. Why does it seem? It seems right today, this moment, in this instant. When Eve stands under that tree, in that moment, in that instant, in that today, the tree looked good. The path of the day is the one that seems right until you look where that path will put you tomorrow. Well, there becomes the problem. I have a very strong feeling that the fruit of that moment in the grasp of Eve was very good. I have a feeling, just a feeling, that when Eve took hold of that fruit, it was very good. It usually is. Today. However, the deception of that moment, the deception of that day, did a job on her tomorrow. You will not die. Remember that? You won't die. You won't die. You won't die. She didn't die that day. She didn't die that day. So from some perspective, Satan was correct in his deception. She didn't die that day, but she did on one of those tomorrows die. And I'm going to tell you, church, here's the truth. And one of these days, tomorrow will be today. She didn't die that day, but she surrendered her tomorrows. And one of these days, tomorrow will be today. So what would make you do that? Come on, come on. What would make you do that? What would make you trade in your tomorrows for today? Because you know what? This is not a Garden of Eden only issue, is it? What is it that would make a person trade in tomorrows for today? Let me take it a step further. What would make a person trade in for forever tomorrows for a momentary today? That's a good question. In fact, it's what God asked Eve. Let me read it to you, verse 13. Then the Lord God asked the woman, "What have you done? What have you done?" And what's her answer? "The serpent did something to me. The serpent did something to me. He deceived me. There is a way that seems right unto a man, but in the end it leads only to death. Today, that tree looked good. But now that I'm confronted with the topic of tomorrows, it's not near as attractive as it was today. The serpent deceived me. That's why I ate it." You see, no one would trade in their tomorrows for today unless they were deceived. And this is where today's main story comes in. The main story today is not about Eve, and it's not about the tree in the garden. And not even from the Old Testament, but I'm going to the New Testament today. Today's story is about a paradigm that exists in this room right now, May 1st, 2016. A theory, a group of ideas about how something should be done, how something should be made, a method by which you do something. Let me set up the story like this. I'm going to ask a series of questions so that we think deeply, and then I'll reveal the paradigm. If there really is a deceiver, if there really is a liar that tricks people, and he tricks people into trading their tomorrows for today, and if there really is a truth, a creator that offers an unlimited amount of tomorrows, just ponder the thought. If there is a creator that offers me and you an unlimited amount of tomorrows, to anyone who will believe the truth, then who should be the people who hear the truth about unlimited tomorrows? So let me give you a visual. If there is a gift of God that is called unlimited tomorrows, and it is truth, and you have been made aware of the availability of the gift of unlimited tomorrows, and now you possess the gift of the knowledge of unlimited tomorrows, who do you think should be the people who you share the gift with? Stay with me. Who should be the people who hear the truth about unlimited tomorrows? If you were in charge, and I'll give you a hint, to some degree you are. If you're in charge of sharing the good news of unlimited tomorrows, who would you start with? So today, you now have the gift of unlimited tomorrows. You have the knowledge of the gift of unlimited tomorrows. Who will you share that gift with? Where would you start? If you were in possession of this good news, where would you start? This is where the paradigm comes in. Do you think we operate under the same paradigm right now, today, in this room, in this church, in this era? Do you think we operate under the same paradigm of Jesus regarding whom we should be sharing the good news with? What good news? That there is a unlimited tomorrow's gift of God available and within your reach, and you're not too short. Would you start with nice people? Now you have the knowledge of the gift, okay? Unlimited tomorrows, right? I've got it. I understand it. It's mine. Now I can share it with somebody else. Would you start with nice people? Would you start with good people? Would you start with family members?
No, because they're not nice people.
Who would you start with? Come on, who would you start with? Would you start with people that liked you? What if the people said they didn't like you? Would you still give them the knowledge of unlimited tomorrows? Would you start with people who look like you, dress like you, act like you? Who would you start with? Would you start with nasty people, ugly people, dirty people? Would you start with people that just right out say, I don't like you and I don't want what you've got? Would you start with them? What's the paradigm that you would operate under? How should this be done? What? How should this be done? I now have the knowledge of unlimited tomorrows. What am I going to do with it? If I'm going to share it, who would I share it with? Let me do this. Consider the two significant trees in the Garden of Eden. And I'm going to make a spiritual picture. Consider the first tree is the knowledge of good and evil. I'm going to call that the forbidden tree, okay? There's a forbidden tree, and it has fruit on it. But there's another tree. There's another tree called the tree of life. It is the tree of life that offers unlimited tomorrows. What do you think was on the tree of life? So there's two trees, right? And now you have knowledge of both of those trees. The tree of knowledge of good and evil, let's call it the today tree. Why? Because it looks pretty good today. But to eat of that tree, you're giving up the unlimited tomorrows. Ask Adam and Eve. But it looks good today. There's a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And if you eat of that tree, it's a transaction. You give up your unlimited tomorrows for an event that happens today. There's a tree of life. It's unlimited tomorrows, unlimited life. We call it eternal life. Here's the deal. Eve could reach both, and so can you. Stay with me. Eve could reach both, and so can you. You are not too short, and the path is long enough. The question is this: do you think anyone is too short? Have you in your mind already established that anyone is too short? I've told you that Eve was tall enough. She's not too short. The path that Satan laid in front of her led all the way up to the tree, and when she got to the tree, she was tall enough. She was not too short to reach its fruit. Can you think of anybody that you have already determined in your paradigm, in your mind, that's too short for the tree of unlimited tomorrows? I want you to think deeply right now. Do you think anyone else, can you think of anyone else too short to reach the tree of life that leads to unlimited tomorrows? This question, these questions are going to force you and I to look at our paradigm. Now I can tell you the truth. Now I can give you the plan of the one who made the tree of life and made us all, listen, tall enough to reach it and receive unlimited tomorrows. It's found in Luke chapter 19. Here comes the story. Jesus entered Jericho and he made his way through the town. There was a man there named Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector in the region, and he, Zacchaeus, had become very rich. He tried to get a look at Jesus, but he was, too short. He was too short to see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore fig tree beside the road, for Jesus was going to pass that way. His name is Zacchaeus and he works for the Internal Revenue Service of that day. He is rich and he's gotten rich through extortion, extorting his own people. Nobody likes Zacchaeus, and I'll give you a guess why. Do you like taxes? I don't. Nobody likes Zacchaeus, much less a cheating tax collector. One more thing. Zacchaeus is a wee little man. And a wee little man was he. I don't know why, but I just can't go through this without saying that. He was too short to see Jesus. Stay with me. He was too short to see Jesus. Can I insert a spiritual picture here that's very relevant? Zacchaeus is too short to reach the tree of life. Zacchaeus understands that he is too short to reach the tree of life and experience unlimited tomorrows. I think Zacchaeus wants to take hold of the tree of life and unlimited tomorrows, so he does something profound. He runs ahead and he climbs into a sycamore fig tree. Wrong tree, but good intentions. He's at least trying. Sycamore trees don't give unlimited tomorrows, even if you sit in them all day. But someone special has come to town today. And I'm going to tell you, spiritually speaking, someone special has come to Jericho today, and he is carrying information about the tree of life. That's a good tree. His name is Jesus. Remember, we're looking for a paradigm of truth versus a paradigm of the world, a paradigm of God versus a paradigm of man. Next verse, verse 5. When Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. Zacchaeus, he said, quick, come down. I must be a guest in your home today. Now listen, here we go. This will be the first disruption of your paradigm. The story is clear. There's a great crowd in this scene. So heavy is the crowd that Zacchaeus needs to climb a tree, because all the tall people are in front of the short people. There's a great crowd, and Jesus has come to Jericho with good news about the tree of life that gives unlimited tomorrows. And I'm going to ask you a question. Who does he go to first? There's a huge crowd of people gathering in Jericho. Let's call them the tall people. And who does he go to first? Zacchaeus, a tax collecting cheater. What does that do to your paradigm, church? Of all the people in Jericho Jesus could have approached that day, you know who he went to? A tax collecting cheater. Do you think, spiritually speaking, that Zacchaeus' resume, his list of worldly accomplishments, made him worthy of Jesus that day? Or do you think that his resume, his list of worldly cheating accomplishments, made him too short to reach the tree of life that day? If you were in charge, is Zacchaeus tall enough to have Jesus? Or is he too short? Listen very carefully. I wonder if Jesus was looking for the ones that were the shortest in all of Jericho. What? I wonder if Jesus on purpose is looking for the shortest people in Jericho. No, I'm not talking about stature. I wonder if Jesus' paradigm was to find the very ones that would have the hardest time reaching the tree of life, and thus he sought them out because they were too short. They couldn't reach it. Do you look for tall people when you go to Jericho? Church, do you look for tall people when you go to Jericho? I'm supposed to be an ambassador of Christ. My Jericho's in Kentucky. Do you look for tall people when you go to Jericho? Would you seek out a notorious sinner if you had been given the truth about unlimited tomorrows? What's your paradigm? Would you seek out a notorious sinner? Let's see. Who's the most rotten in the crowd? You. That lady just stuck her head down over there. Let's see what Zacchaeus does with the calling, okay? Here we go. Verse 6. Zacchaeus quickly climbed down and he took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. You know why he's excited? Because maybe there's a chance I'm not too short. Maybe there's just a chance that I'm not too short to reach the tree of life. Verse 7. But the people were displeased. What's their paradigm? He has gone to be a guest of a notorious sinner. They grumbled. Do you know why? Because their paradigm. They thought tall people should get the first shot at the tree of life. But tall people, in reality, if you just stop for a moment, they're already much closer to those lower branches than short people. Why do you start with them? Will short people, nasty, short, cheating tax collectors, ever actually let go? You see, here's the deal. If there are two trees in this spiritual analogy, the tree of knowledge of good and evil that leads to death, and the tree of life that leads to unlimited tomorrows, would you let go of the tree of death to take hold of the tree of life? You can't have both trees. You'll have to let go of that one to take hold of this one. Will Zacchaeus let go of the first tree? Let's see if he's too short. Verse 8. Meanwhile, Zacchaeus stood before the Lord and said, I will give half my wealth to the poor. Lord, and if I have cheated people on their taxes, I will give them back four times as much. I got a question. I wonder if tall people would do that. What? Give half their wealth to the poor. I wonder if tall people would do that. People who, in their own mind, have spent a lot of time with their heads up in the branches of the tree of life. This short person, what's he doing? I'll give half of all I have to the poor, and I'll repay that which I have stored. It worked. You know what? I'm going to tell you. Let me tell you about the story. It worked. It actually worked. What? Jesus looked at a person who could not reach the tree of life and said, here, I'll show you how to reach the tree of life. And it worked. He actually let go of the tree of death and took hold of the tree of life. It worked. It worked. God's not a respecter of persons. He actually likes short people. Even IRS agent, short people. The tall people of Jericho, what do you think about them? They're not happy. The tall people of Jericho are grumbling because they look at Zacchaeus as unworthy of the tree of life. Do you look at some people like that? All right, here's where it hits the road right now, everybody. It hits the road. Do you look at anybody like you think, well, they don't deserve the tree of life? Do you get to choose? Do you get to pick? Do I get to pick? Jesus looked at Zacchaeus and he saw that he would never reach the tree of life and receive the gift of unlimited tomorrows unless somebody helped him up. And Jesus said, that's why I'm here. I'm going to help you up so that you'll reach the tree of life. You're not too short, Zacchaeus. That's where we come in. That's what we're supposed to be doing. Did anybody tell you that, church? That's what we're supposed to be doing, helping people, even short people, especially short people, reach the tree of life and experience unlimited tomorrows. Now look at how Jesus summarizes his encounter with Zacchaeus. Next verse, verse 9. Jesus responded to the grumblers. Grumblers, notorious sinner. Salvation has come to this home today. For this man has shown himself to be a true son of Abraham. Salvation has come to this home. You know what that really means? Unlimited tomorrows have come to Zacchaeus. He now can reach the tree of life. And he let go of the tree of death. Jesus loved the unlovable tax collector. Jesus looked past the sin-filled man that had taken hold of the forbidden tree of death. And he offers him what you and I are supposed to be telling the world about. There is a tree of life that offers unlimited tomorrows, and you are not too short. Do you know why? Do you know why he did it? This is my main point today. Everybody listen. Forget your paradigm. This is the truth. The next verse, verse 10. For the Son of Man came to seek and save those who are lost. There it is. Why'd you think he came? For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the Zacchaeuses of the world. The ones who think they're too short. But when Jesus looked at them, they're not too short at all. Jesus came to make short people tall enough to reach the tree of life. And guess what? We are all short people. In Romans 3:23, it says, "For everyone has sinned." I want you to focus on this word right now in case you're living in a spiritual deception of your own. For everyone has sinned, and we all fall short of God's glorious standard. This is not a denial of sin or a denial of the power of sin to bring death or destruction today. No, this is acknowledgement of sin's power and then offers a cure to sin. You can reach the tree of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You and I have been called by God to share the good news with anyone and everyone. Listen carefully to what I'm about to say. You and I, church, we have been commissioned, called by God to share the good news with anyone and everyone. Don't use the world's paradigm about who is worthy of this great gift. Who is worthy? Nobody's worthy. Who should we be telling? Everyone. In Hebrews 4:1, it says, "Therefore, since the promise of entering His rest still stands." Did you know that? May 1st, 2016, the promise of entering His rest, unlimited tomorrows, still stands. And let us be careful, church. Let us be careful. What does that mean? Because He knows the human heart. Let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. I admit today that I am too short to reach the tree of life without Jesus. I don't have any problem saying that out loud. I admit today that I am too short to reach the tree of life. And unless Jesus does what He needs to do to get that path in front of me and that tree within my reach, I won't make it. I admit today that I am also too short and totally unqualified to decide the height and the worthiness of anyone else regarding their access to the tree of life. It's not my job. Time and time again, Jesus did something throughout the Scriptures. Time and time and time again, He does something. He touches the untouchables. You know who Zacchaeus is? He's untouchable. They don't like Him. He touches the untouchables, the lepers. How would you like to be a leper that lived in the time of Jesus? They were untouchable, unclean, unclean. Matthew 8:1, listen, you want to know, does your paradigm match Jesus's? It better. Here's His. Large crowds followed Jesus as He came down the mountainside. Suddenly a man with leprosy approached Him and knelt before Him. Lord, you know what the word Lord means? This leper has come down and calls Him Master. Master, if You are willing, You can heal me and make me clean. I believe You can heal me and make me clean. Jesus reached out and He touched him. Are you supposed to touch lepers? Jesus reached out and He touched him and said, "I am willing. Be healed." Instantly, the leprosy disappeared. Jesus came and He touched the untouchables, the thrown away people of society. He comes and those are the first people He goes to. What about adulterers? There's adulterers in this room today. Do you think you're too short? Listen, there's two trees still today. There's the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and it represents today, and today's pretty sweet sometimes. But would you trade today for unlimited tomorrows? You see, there's a time in which you got to let go of that tree so that you can take hold of the other tree, the tree of life. But in the transaction, is anybody too short? Does Jesus say you're disqualified? Or would you be the first ones He'd come and offer the good news? Let's see. John 8, verse 3. as he was speaking, as Jesus was speaking, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in the act of adultery. Let there be no mistaking, this woman has broken the law, God's law, the act of adultery. They put her in front of the crowd. Teacher, they said to Jesus, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law of Moses says to stone her. What do you say? They were trying to trap him into saying something they could use against him, but Jesus stooped down and he wrote in the dust with his finger. They kept demanding an answer, as so he stood up again and said, all right, but let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone. Can I translate today to fit the sermon? All you tall people, grab a rock. All you tall people that have lived your life up with your heads up in the branches of the tree of life, all of you who believe that you have occupied all the space inside the tree of life on your own power, on your own merit, on your own goodness, you all grab a rock. And guess what? There was nobody. Oh, there was one. His name's Jesus. He is the tree of life, and he would be the only one in that group today that met his qualifications he just set out for the crowd. What's he going to do? Let's see. Verse 8, then he stooped down again and he wrote in the dust. When the accusers heard this, they slipped away one by one, beginning with the oldest until Jesus was left in the middle of the crowd with the woman, just him and her. By the way, that's the way it's going to be at the end too. Just you and him. And Jesus stood up again and said to the woman, where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them? Wasn't there even one of them tall enough to grab a rock, ma'am? Wasn't there even one of them holy enough to meet the standard I just laid out? All you righteous people, self-righteous people, grab a rock. No one. No, Lord, she said, verse 11. And Jesus said, here we go, neither do I. Go and sin no more. Neither do I. This is not freedom to sin. This is freedom from sin. This is what he does that allows us, he makes a pathway that takes us away from the today tree of death and moves us to the unlimited tomorrow tree of life. And he offered it to that adulterous woman that the righteous people thought they ought to be throwing rocks at. Jesus came to not just give unlimited tomorrows, but unlimited tomorrows with him. Listen carefully to what I'm about to say. Not just unlimited tomorrows. Hell will have unlimited tomorrows. But they won't be unlimited tomorrows with him. That's the essence of the follow me message of Christ. Follow me means that you will be not just unlimited tomorrows, but you'll be unlimited tomorrows with me. Even in the inner circle, Jesus surrounded himself with 12 guys, and in the middle of those 12 guys, he had three that he was closest to. But even in the middle of his circle, the same truth applies. Matthew 9:9. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at his tax collector's booth. Follow me. Be my disciple. You know that's what he's asking me and you to do? Did you know that? Follow me. Be my disciple. Jesus said to him, so Matthew got up and he followed him. Later, Matthew invited Jesus and his disciples to his home as dinner guests, along with many tax collectors and other disreputable sinners. Whoa, there goes the neighborhood. But when the Pharisees, you know who they were? They lived with their heads in their own mind in the branches of the tree of life every day. They didn't need somebody else to get to the tree. They're in the tree. But when the Pharisees saw this, what? Jesus is having a dinner with disreputable sinners. They ask his disciples, why does your teacher eat with such scum? When Jesus heard this, he said, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. Healthy people don't need a doctor, and tall people don't need a ladder. And here comes the truth. Whether you like it or not, here comes the truth. We are all sick, and there's no one in this room that can reach the tree of life and unlimited tomorrows unless Jesus helps you up. It won't happen. Think deeply about the next verse, verse 13. In the context of Matthew's calling, disreputable sinners. Next verse, verse 13. Then he added. Now, go and learn the meaning of this scripture. I want you to show mercy. Church, I want you to show mercy, not offer sacrifices. For I have come to call those, I have come to call not those who think they are righteous. I have come not to call those who think they are righteous, but those who know they are sinners. Let me ask you a practical application. Listen, very practical today. You'll be able to understand it and apply it. Who are the most likely to receive the gospel? I've been doing this now 25 years. I've had a chance to share the gospel with a lot of people in a lot of places. Who's most likely to listen to the gospel? Forget your paradigm. I want you to focus on this scripture. Who's most likely? Who's the most likely to accept the gospel? Those who think they are righteous or those who know they are sinners? I'm asking. Who's most likely? Those who think they are righteous or those who admit they are sinners? Who's most likely? Tall people or short people? Well, let's ask Jesus. Because you know what? He's going to answer the question. Luke 18, verse 9. Then Jesus told this story to some who had great confidence in their own righteousness. Can I call them tall people? They had great confidence in their own righteousness, and they scorned everyone else. They scorned the short people. Here's the story. Two men went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other was a despised tax collector. Do you notice there's a lot of taxation going on back in the Bible day? The Pharisee stood by himself and he prayed this prayer. The tall person prayed this prayer. I thank you, God, that I'm not a sinner like everyone else, for I don't cheat, I don't sin, and I don't commit adultery. I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give you a tenth of my income. But the tax collector, okay, the tall person has just spoken. Why is Jesus telling this story? And the tax collector stood at a distance and he dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, "Oh God, be merciful, for I am a sinner." I tell you, Jesus, listen, Jesus is the one you're going to stand in front of. And I'm going to stand in front of him. And I know in advance how he answers the test. He says, I tell you, this sinner, not the Pharisee. The short person, not the tall person. The sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home justified before God. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled. What do you think that means? Those who exalt themselves will be made short. And those who humble themselves will be made tall. They will be exalted. One day, the great reversal will take place. Those who have lived their lives in acknowledgement of their own unworthiness will become tall people that live in the tree of life's branches. And those tall people who thought their self-righteousness would win them favor with God will become very short, perhaps so short they cannot even reach the branches at all. I know what some of you are thinking. How do we carry out this task of sharing the gospel with people that probably many don't want to hear the word? When I hear his great commission, go into all the world and preach the gospel, it seems overwhelming to me sometimes. The task is too large, but it's not too large for God. Listen. I'm convinced the church is the unstoppable movement of God. And all we got to do is believe him. And it can't be stopped. It cannot be stopped. Listen to what God told Moses. And here's the reason I use this. Do you think to Moses it seemed possible one guy to walk into Pharaoh and overthrow a nation with a stick? Does it even seem possible that one guy could deliver 2 million people out of Egypt and move them into the promised land? Does this seem possible? In Numbers 11:23, the Lord answered Moses when he was having one of those moments. He said, "Is the Lord's arm too short, Moses? Do you think I'm too short?" You will now see whether or not what I say will come true for you. Now put all of this in context of the New Testament. Today, God's calling to His church. Matthew 24:14. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. There's no force on the earth that's going to stop it. The question is whether we're going to be a part of it. Because this is going to happen. And the good news about the kingdom. You know what I'm going to say? The good news about there is a tree of life and unlimited tomorrows that Jesus can make you reach. The good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world so that all the nations will hear it and then the end will come. It's been announced. It will happen. It's unstoppable. Do you think God's arm's too short? The whole world's going to hear. The tall people and the short. It will be preached, and then the end will come. It won't happen by might. It won't happen by power. It won't happen by our cleverness or our programs or our methods. It'll happen by the Spirit of God, by the power of God. It will be preached. The nations will hear it, and the end will come. In the end, there will be rest. I look forward to that day. There will be rest. And don't fall short of this rest. Don't fall short. What, there is a way that seems right unto a man, but in the end, it leads to death. Don't fall short of this rest. Hebrews 4:1. Therefore, since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. For we also have had the gospel preached to us. We've had the gospel preached to us, just as they did before us. But the message they heard was of no value to them because those who heard it did not combine it with, what's the last word? Faith. It was of no value. What? There's no value for me telling you that there's a tree of unlimited tomorrows if you don't believe it. It's of no value to you. You just have a head knowledge. It's of no value. You have to combine it with faith. There was somebody in your past that thought you were not short, that you were not too short, and they told you and they showed you about the tree of life, demonstrating Christ through their life. For me, it was many years ago, but I'm really happy. They didn't care how tall I was or how simple I was. They just told me that there was a tree of unlimited tomorrows. And I have people scattered throughout my entire life that demonstrated faith to me. They showed me the gospel. Ladies and gentlemen, that is our calling in this world. We are the light of the world. We are the salt of the earth. We must be revealing that there is a tree of life, of unlimited tomorrows for a generation that's looking at the church for hope and looking at the church for truth. But unless you believe it and have it by faith, it will be of no value to anybody else or you. You must combine it with faith. Now, because somebody told me about this tree, and somebody lived out loud the gospel in my life, sowed seeds into this person's life. They didn't care whether I was tall or short. Now I live in expectancy. Revelation 2:7. I close with this. Listen. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what He is saying to the churches. It's happening in this room right now. Anyone with ears to hear today, you better listen to what the Spirit is saying to this church. To everyone who is victorious, I will give fruit from the tree of life in the paradise of God. I will give you, what a deal, the tree of life, unlimited tomorrows. If you're victorious, do you think you're too short? I know in an audience this large, there's probably some people in here that in your life, you know, I have people all the time, they'll say something like this, you know, Terry, when I get my life straightened out, I'll come to Christ. I'll say, you'll never come to Christ if that's how you think it works. You come to Christ because you cannot straighten your life out on your own. You will never reach that tree until you acknowledge you can't reach that tree on your own. Jesus told me to tell you something today. I'm going to ask Chad to come out. And he told me to tell you this. You are not too short. That with him, you can reach the tree of life. And you know what the tree of life is? Look at this picture behind me, this guy trying to reach up through the line. You know what? I came to this spiritual analogy that the tree of life is the cross. Interesting that there was a tree in the garden and there was a tree that our Savior was nailed to. A tree. And the cross represents the tree of life, and you can reach the tree of life because the tree of life is not a piece of wood. The tree of life is the one who made the original tree, who placed his life on a tree so that you would be tall enough. You are not too short. We are not too short. And after we acknowledge that we're not too short and we now, because of what Jesus did, can reach the tree of unlimited tomorrows, the question is, who are you going to share that bit of good news with? The answer is anyone and everyone, because no one is too short. The invitation of Jesus Christ to reach the tree of life and its unlimited tomorrows is open. Let's stand. Jill Shiflett, and Jill came today. She wants to officially make herself a member of this body of Christ. And we welcome you, Jill, to travel with us toward the promised land. And I want you to welcome her when this service is over today. And I don't think Jill's the only one that needs to make a commitment to the body of Christ here. What are you waiting on? Father, thank you for Jill. Thank you for your church. Thank you, Lord, that by the blood of Christ, by the cross, we are tall enough to reach now the tree of life. We have access to unlimited tomorrows in the kingdom of heaven, in your presence. And I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing here. And I pray, Lord, that each one of us, all of us in this room today, will recognize this responsibility, that now that we have been given enough by Christ, enough to take hold of this treasure called life, that we would share the good news with anyone and everyone, those the world has rejected, whoever you put in front of us, may we be messengers of this good news. I pray in Jesus' name and amen. Won't y'all come welcome Jill, please.